Look, we don't always have to remain on the Going Merry. We can also join the Water Seven, and this place is goddamn beautiful. But what's even more beautiful is that Nami outfit. But before we even get to that moment, let's just talk about the rest of the chapter. The chapter opens up with this amazing celebration of, I mean, look, they're still celebrating their victory. And they've been drinking a little bit of alcohol. In fact, they've been drinking Absinthe the Green Fairy. One, if not the most strongest of types of alcohol. And it's very interesting because they specifically mention about how it has like hallucination effects. And we are, you know, if we cut to the very last panel, we see something that is unlike real life. So I'm really curious what is going to occur in these moments, but we'll discuss more of that at the end. We also have a very humorous moment where Dory and Broggy are confirming that they are still fighting. So it's like, okay, they are just really here for like a temporary break, and then they're going to continue their fight, which is, I mean, sure, whatever. And then I also really love that, you know, the juxtaposition from this comedic, fun party to now having Kuma and Bonnie being able to sit on the deck of the giant ship and just look into the horizon and just be able to just enjoy. You know, Bonnie saying that we finally got to see the horizon together, and just having them both being able to bear witness to this, and Kuma having a smile on his face. It was just a moment that was just so sweet, because Kuma deserves everything good in his life. He has sacrificed so much. He, right at this moment, we don't even know if he can physically be able to talk. We don't even know what kind of mental state he's in. All we know is that he can feel the emotion of being with his daughter at that moment, and that is more than enough for Kuma, and that is like everything he's ever wanted in life. So if he's happy, I'm happy. And then we move on to another strong moment with Bartolomeo, who is really showing his dedication to Luffy by drinking the poison that one of the Shanks crew has given him. And I love this scene because it's just like, we're just going to show how powerful Bartolomeo is, but also that he's aware of the bad doings that he's doing. Like, he burned Shanks's flag for the sake of Luffy, but upon being met with aggression, does he like, no, my boss wasn't a part of this. The Yonko crew, Luffy was not a part of this. I just thought I'd do it in his name, man. Like, he realized his wrongdoing. So there's like a little bit of like, you still want to be a bad pirate, but you also still want to do it in Luffy's name. It's like, you're not quite mixing very well. But I do love that he drank the poison, even though it wasn't poison, you know, showing his dedication. And I love that aspect of it. And then we cut to a moment where they're on the ship and Shanks is like smiling. He's laughing. And it's like, you know, his crew asks like, wait, what's going on? Why are you laughing? He's like, don't. I love his dedication to Luffy. He is just so awesome. And I think that moment really makes that moment where Shanks is like looking like it has like a dour face on him, where it's like, I think he's just trying to hold a laugh when he's seeing Bartolomeo just drink this poison, because he's like, I can't believe your dedication to Luffy is this real. I love it. And then we got Yasop's like, hey bro, side. Bam! Boom! The ship blows up. I this is so funny. I think Yasop just like, okay, let me teach him a lesson here. Okay. It's very funny. It also kind of just shows us how much more powerful the Yonkos are and how much more we need to get to a point where we can actually like properly face off against Yonkos, because they're kind of insane at this point. And we now that we've learned about what's happening with the Shanks crew, we are now moving over to see what's happening with the Blackbeard Pirates. And this is the one where we got some interesting little tidbits. First off, Moria has escaped, so now we officially know that Moria is no longer on Hachinosu. We also learned that they actually really care about Moria, so they had some sort of plan to keep Moria with them. So that is very interesting to note, because they also try to keep Kobe, and they are also now keeping Garp. So at some point, Moria was meant to be either some sort of like convincing to join our crew or some sort of like bargaining chip. So that is very interesting to note that they did keep Moria around chained up, like locked. So very interesting. And then we also have the official confirmation, and everyone kind of figured this, but like, it's nice to have like finally have Blackbeard like set a firm goal of like, I want to capture the One Piece, I got pudding, and I need pudding to decipher the poneglyphs, like those three. So that was, I love that we're just like throwing that out right. We don't have to worry about like, oh, he's probably going to do this and he's probably going to do that. It's like, now we know like he's going to do this, right? And I always appreciate those types of chapters. We also learn that Garp is still alive and he is in prison, and Kuzan's like, yeah, man, I just tried to kill him. And I'm just like, what? That was like the worst deception roll of all time. We all know you're not lying. And the Blackbeard parents are like, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Kuzan was definitely trying to kill Garp. We believe you, buddy. I really, this feels like way too easy. Maybe I'm just like thinking too deeply about the relationship between Garp and Kuzan, where they both could kill each other if they wanted to, but they definitely did not do that purposefully because they wanted themselves, because they care about each other, right? And the Blackbeard Pirates are kind of just taking Kuzan at his word, and I'm not quite sure why that is. Like, I would be more suspicious of a Marine joining us, but like I said, we just don't have a sense of time. Like, how long has Kuzan been here? Is he even worth it? Or if we cut back to when the Blackbeard Pirates originally met Kuzan, Kuzan had the possibility of killing everyone. I mean, he froze a majority of the Blackbeard Pirates at the time. So it's really difficult to actually say one way or the other. But yeah, I don't believe that Kuzan actually tried to kill Garp. That seems a little bit out of character for him. And we also get Katarine Devon showing up with Van Auger, and they're like, hey, we got this Mud Man with us. Okay, so now we know that all the Blackbeard Pirates are all together and all ready to fight. And oh well, I guess the one person we're missing is Lafitte, and Lafitte is out there watching over the revolutionaries taking over the shipping deposit that is sending food up to the world government. And this brings up a very interesting thing, is that we've always seen that the Blackbeard Pirates have always been butting heads with the revolutionaries, and more recently did we learn that the Blackbeard Pirates are trying to gain favor with the world government to become their own like city or nation or whatever. So it makes sense that Lafitte is here watching the celestial dragon's food being burned and tossed away for Lafitte to make a move on the revolutionaries, to at least stop, at least to get the food back. Because what a crazy bargaining chip would it be to not only have Garp chained up and fixing the food for the celestial dragons. In fact, depending on how much, and it might be Lafitte that knows the most about the world government, because Lafitte, I mean, the first time we saw Lafitte was literally in the Shichibukai meeting room. He teleported there, right? So we definitely know that he can get around if he needs to. And it makes me very, very curious to know if they will say, if the Blackbeard Pirates will either go to the world government and go like, hey, we can fix the supply chain, we can give you Garp, but you give us something back. Or, and this is the thing that I think would be even more interesting, if the Blackbeard Pirates skip the world government and go directly to the celestial dragons. Imagine Blackbeard wanting to gain favor among the world government, and he goes directly to the celestial dragons to give them their food. The celestial dragons will then celebrate Blackbeard. Well, maybe not celebrate, but if Blackbeard can gain favor among the celestial dragons, I would not be surprised the world government would have to do the celestial dragons' bidding of whatever Teach and the celestial dragons have agreed upon. So I think that would be a far more interesting plot point. It's just maybe we'll have to figure out a good way for the Celestial Dragons to accept a character like Blackbeard, but there is a possibility with the food shortage. So I'm very excited to see how everything is going to turn out there. And then our final situation occurring is that the Straw Hats are missing. And not all the Straw Hats. In fact, it's the original four plus Chopper that are missing. We see a bunch of panels that we have Robin, Jinbei, Bonnie. I don't know if we see Kuma, but we could kind of assume that Kuma is like still sitting on the deck of a ship. And we see Frankie. None of the new characters, basically, since Drum Island are there. So, and we get that we know that for sure Luffy is missing, and we know for sure that Nami is missing, but we don't know about the other three. But we could kind of assume that the other three are probably with Nami, and that just makes me so happy, because it's like, oh, we're finally getting the original crew again. Another split the party moment, and we finally get the original crew together. So I'm really happy about that. I'm really excited to see how this turns out. We have Nami in one of the baddest fits I have seen. It is insane how thirsty Oda is. And I mean, we all know Oda has married a Nami cosplayer, so we definitely know Oda's like, hey girl, you mind? Look at this new fit I got for Nami. You know, so I am really very excited to see one of the other outfits for the Straw Hats, because if this is the marking of an Elbath outfit, oh boy, I am so freaking excited to see more. It makes me so happy. But okay, but there's that other things in the chapter. We notice the environment around Nami, and it's all like Lego bricks. Like, you know, everything feels like Legos. So is she in some sort of dollhouse? I mean, we have seen a scene, and I believe it's like 1124 or 1125, where everyone is sitting on the couch of the ship in the Giants. And they're microscopic. They're so tiny. So this would make sense if this was some sort of dollhouse or something. It's very, very interesting to see what this is. It is also very hard to determine, because we also are under the understanding that the alcohol has made them hallucinate. They're saying that they woke up 2 days later, and the narrator box that was from those panels was implying that they missed Elbath. So they sailed too far past Elbath. And it's very interesting, because I think with the combination of the alcohol, I don't think they fell asleep within those 2 days. I just think that they have completely blacked out and just forgot the last 2 days. And then upon suddenly waking up, you know, so we'll definitely start to have moments where we start piecing together what exactly happened previously in those last 2 days. We might see a hallucination of maybe the original Straw Hat crew taking the Sunny and going somewhere, like, you know, drunk driving. You know, we don't really know what exactly is happening, but I do believe that they did not knock out for 2 days. That they were conscious for 2 days. They just blacked out and forgot it all. And also, you know, they were most likely hallucinating as well. We still have yet to see the true hallucination effect in hand, but I'm so excited to see what the hell were happening. Is this going to be a mini arc, or is this a quick way to get to Elbath? Like, what exactly is happening at this moment? But that is it for chapter One Piece 1126. I'm so excited to see 1127, because we are moving. Things are happening. Like I said, the post arc stories are some of the most fun, because we're finally catching up with the rest of the world, and god damn is it so good. All right, I'll see y'all later.